What's the oil pressure looking like?
75 PSI, baby. Oh my God, it's bad, dude.
We stand by the idea that if we wouldn't put it on our car, we wouldn't sell it to you. Which, more than ever, carries a lot of weight as we've finally begun to develop our own in-house parts. In this video, we wanted to show you the testing and results that went into our new BMW N20 oil pan baffle that's now available at fcbureau.com.
So we've shown that the N20 could be a really good performance platform. It does have its fair share of issues, one of those being timing chain related problems, but we've already shown you how to fix that. But nobody seems to want to talk about the oil starvation problems. I've installed a lot of parts, I've built a lot of cars, I don't know how to design parts to fix problems, but I am joined by somebody who knows exactly how to do that. Alex, talk to me about what we did here.
Yeah, so when BMW designed the N20, they probably expected it to be doing this. This is a 200,000 mile daily driver that spent its whole life on the highway. And when you made it steer and stop like an F80 M3, well, we uncovered the oil starvation issue pretty quickly. So today we're gonna show you how we fixed it. In order to create solutions, you first have to start with a control. So we've started with this, a four-cylinder 328i that's bone stock. We've come here to the FC Puro Proving Grounds to show you how braking, lateral Gs, and sustained G-forces really are the Achilles heel of the N20. And then we're gonna show you how we fixed it. So we're gonna start off by simulating a spirited drive going about 8/10 around the proving grounds, and we'll show you guys the results. Starting right now. Already hitting the error noise. Chunder steer. It's like a big slushy go-kart. All right.
It dropped hard there, dude. I think that last turn, it dropped down to like 13 PSI, and then it immediately shot up to 100 plus.
Holy crap. All right, so now we're gonna show you what hard braking looks like. You ready?
Yep.
Like a cliff. All right. And now we're going to show the pièce de résistance, which is the cavities on the right hand side of the oil pan, the stock pan, are meant to hold additional oil, which means on a left hand turn, all your oil just says bye bye and goes in the storage closet to the right of the pickup. So we're on the skid pad and we're going to see what happens if we just keep turning left, NASCAR style.
Oh my God, it's bad, dude. It's real bad.
Should we see what it does to the right?
Let's go to the right.
Just to confirm. I think you're on a different story of the building than I am at this point. It's definitely a lot better though.
It's way better.
So yeah, that pretty much confirms that to the left is the worst for the stock oil pan.
Using 3D scans of the motor, balance shaft assembly, and both of the plastic and aluminum oil pans, we were able to create a bolt-on solution to resolve the N20's oil pressure issues. This baffle creates a new flow path that picks up right underneath the oil drain on the side of the block, bringing oil directly to the baffled pickup like a one-way street. And aside from hugging everything around it, the side baffles extend to cover the oil reservoirs on the right-hand side, keeping oil from lurching into those chambers under left-hand turns, which we knew was one of the stock pan's worst traits.
And then this is gonna sit right like that and prevent oil from going into here, you know, wherever it wants to on left-hand turns, and then also going forward under braking. And then the oil drain is right here. It'll spill out onto this tray and be directed right in there instead of pooling in the front of the pan.
The installation of this beautiful piece is really simple. Just a few bolts into the bottom of the balance shaft assembly gives you peace of mind that your engine will never be without its arguably most sacred fluid, oil, which not only provides lubrication of all the moving parts, but aids in cooling as well.
All right, so that was terrible, but now we're in this 320 SI with our own baffle design. And we're gonna do the same spirited lap at about 8/10. I should mention, this car can stop, steer, and change direction a heck of a lot faster than that slushy tire, completely stock F30, so.
And that F30 actually has the same M performance brakes on it. It has the 370, so it has the same brakes.
Right.
But it doesn't have nearly as much grip, so it doesn't stop as well.
Right.
Yeah, under braking.
Fourth gear! That was fourth gear in the slide! I don't know exactly what it's doing, but you sound less alarmed.
It's not nearly as terrifying. In fact, I would define it as very, very stable.
Yeah.
I don't know, like, major drop-offs and then huge increases.
Yep. All right, so the same hard braking test as before, but this car stops a lot sooner than that stock F30.
I mean, literally.
It's fine.
Totally flat.
It went down to basically idle request around 30-ish PSI.
Yep.
Now we're gonna do the skid pad. This is gonna be a lot more G-force than the stock car could do. Oh. How's it looking?
It's pretty flat.
Heck yeah. It's making my eyeballs go into your head. All right, well, if the oil pressure is stable, then I see no reason we can't do this.
Yeah.
What's the oil pressure looking like?
75 PSI, baby.
Dude, this thing can do this all day long. The best.
It works.
It works great. For good measure, should we go to the right as well?
I guess we should go to the right.
For science.
For science.
Yeah,
you know. This is all for science.
Yeah. No other reason.
Nope.
The caster really helps it get right into that angle. You can basically steer it with one hand. Third gear, dude.
Oil pressure was mint the entire time, dude.
That's sick. Well, I think that concludes a pretty big victory for not only our design, but the N20 as a whole. I mean, as basic of an engine as these cars came with.
Yep.
And with a simple tune, turbo upgrade, and a bolt-on baffle, you can stay sideways at 40 miles an hour with no issue. Okay, so that was a blast. And just to show you guys that this data is right here, right now, on this Autel, we've just saved the four logs we did. So this is the first lap, and then the braking and the skid pad.
Yeah.
So let's go through.
We'll go stock F30.
Yep, stock F30, spirited driving.
All right.
So as you can see, just in our 8 out of 10th lap around the track, we're experiencing up to like a 60 or 70% loss in oil pressure from turns, braking, and anything under 36 PSI, 35 PSI is less than it would be at idle.
This is the right-hand turn going onto the front straight, the bottom of the skid pad, where
18.
We had that massive drop to 18.
Yep.
But then you have this crazy recovery where it shoots back up.
Yeah.
I think it went up to almost 100 PSI from when I was looking at it. So my thought would be if oil is moving away from the pickup,
yeah,
it's causing the pump to cavitate, and then once that oil moves back to the pickup,
right,
it's trying to command, because these are variable displacement pumps, so it's
commanding all of it.
Right, and it goes, holy crap, I need oil, and then the oil gets there, and then you get this crazy spike.
Right, so it's going from 15 PSI oil at its worst to 105, all within...
like, instantaneous.
One second.
Yeah.
Half a second. So anytime you're under about 30 PSI, it's not going to do your rod bearings or any part of your engine.
Turbocharger.
Turbocharger.
Probably like the overhead valve train.
All of that.
All of it.
You're going to be allowing those components to go metal to metal for a brief moment, or at least scuff each other.
Yeah.
All right, so now we're on to the hard braking in the stock car.
So, yeah, we're at 78 PSI, right, through the skid pad.
Yep.
Entering the skid pad, you start to brake.
42.
And
40,
it just falls
30,
off a cliff.
24.
It should be at 30-something, 36 PSI for idle speed.
Yep.
Because you can see where engine speed is.
17 PSI.
And it does, engine speed gets to idle, and it's basically, oil pressure is falling off a map.
Yep. And not to mention...
And then it recovers back to idle.
This engine is either about to be loaded back up again.
Yes.
Or you're downshifting and putting compression load on the crankshaft.
Yep.
So even if you're not burning fuel, you're still putting pressure on the crank bearings.
Well, look at that spike on recovery.
It's crazy. So it stays below 30 PSI for a good 5 seconds? 6 seconds?
Almost.
Yeah. So imagine this. A track might have 5 or 10 braking zones per lap. And you're staying halfway below optimum PSI for that entire braking zone, which is 5 or 10 seconds.
It's not like a one-time scenario,
right?
Where it happened one time out of 1,000 miles of driving. It happens,
which would happen on the highway,
exactly.
Right.
This is a sustained situation. So this is when we're sitting at the skid pad, and then we start to go into that sustained
left-hand turn.
Yeah, left-hand turn.
Yep. So you can see it spiked when I hit the gas.
Yep.
Oh wow.
And then it just falls off a cliff.
19.
And it just stays down there. So we're 5 seconds, 6 seconds in, 7 seconds.
It still hasn't recovered. All right, so this is truly worst case scenario. While it's not the lowest oil pressure we've seen, we're at 3,400 RPM, I'm on the gas, I'm applying torque, and we're at only 22 pounds of oil pressure. And that is where you could kill a rod bearing, a main bearing, you name it, in an N20. And for all we know, this could be responsible for a lot of the issues that other people have had with N20s.
18.898 PSI.
At what, 40 miles an hour, 50% throttle?
Yeah.
That's bad.
Yeah, NASCAR style does not like it too well.
We're gonna move on to the results from this car now with our bolt-on oil baffle, and let's take a look at the results. So that's 72 PSI oil pressure. We're now entering the skid pad. It was 60, 52, 53, 68, and climbing. So what that means then is that the targeted oil pressure from the DME is being hit.
Correct.
Because it has the oil it needs to hit that target.
Yep. But you don't see, I mean, like, sure, you see oil pressure increasing and decreasing here, but the point is the pressure stays very high the entire time.
Yep.
Which is an indication of little to no cavitation. I would say there's no cavitation happening here at all.
Yeah. 53 was the lowest we saw, and that's still, what, 15 above
minimum. That's at 3,800 RPMs, though.
Yeah, and that's still 15 PSI above the lowest requested oil pressure that would ever be given by the ECU.
Yeah.
So it looks like our worst case scenario in spirited driving was 49 PSI, but for pretty much the whole lap, we're seeing 60, 75 PSI.
Yep.
If anything, the harder suspension is probably just jostling the oil around more. And like we said earlier, this is probably half a G more in braking and cornering than that stock car could do.
Yeah, it has no rubber bushings in the suspension. It has
monoballs,
wider tires, monoballs, stickier tires, more aggressive brake pads, more track width.
And we're still more than doubling the oil pressure throughout the carousel and throughout the rest of the lap.
So we would say, like, this car is the extreme polar opposite of what a stock F30-328 would be.
Yep.
And oil pressure remains stable the entire time.
So we're getting into the hard braking and skid pad data now for this car, where we stopped to a complete full stop from, I think, like 85 miles an hour, which is, I think, about 20 mile an hour faster than the stock car.
Yep.
And here's what that looks like.
So let's get into it.
So we started about 60 PSI after coming around that corner. We're at 40.
So revs are dropping because obviously we're coming to a stop.
Yep, so I'm on the brakes here. We're at 37. And keep in mind, the minimum requested idle oil pressure is around 36 PSI. We're at 35.5.
At idle speed, at 720 RPMs.
So I've stopped at this point.
Yes.
Wow. So we've more than doubled the oil pressure while having half a G more braking with stickier tires.
And then here's the trip around the skid pad in the left-hand turn, which
That was a blast.
Turned into a left-hand, yep. This is where you were like, okay, we made a couple of left-hand turns, cool. Yep. Now, the car wants to go sideways, so let's just make it as extreme as possible. This is now you're in the slide. 4,200 RPMs, like we're what, third gear?
Yeah, loading it up.
Yep, 73 PSI, oil temps 218 degrees, so this is the car's being hammered on at this point. And as we come through here,
54 PSI, you know, 53,
it's all very
70.
It's all very correlated to engine speed and engine load.
Yep.
Oil temp still increasing, so you know, I would say you're probably going to see a little bit of an oil pressure change, or at least commanded with oil temp, because it's going to be thinned a little bit. But again,
under load, that's probably shifting into fourth gear, exiting the slide, and we have way more oil pressure than before.
Yeah. And this thing, under the most extreme scenario possible, which is the car going sideways in a consistent skid, lap over lap over lap, at high engine load, high drivetrain load, oil pressure just remains solid.
That's awesome. Well, I'd say that was a pretty conclusive day of testing.
100%.
It's pretty crazy what one little part can do. Make sure to check out fcpro.com to buy parts like this and everything else we use to build this F30.
Yeah, we're running out of daylight here, and we have all of this place ourselves, so I think for the sake of science, we need to do a little bit more testing.
Yeah, I agree. So be sure to like, comment, and subscribe, and like I said, check out fcpro.com for all your parts and fun stuff like this. Thanks for watching.